क्रिप्टो दोस्त के एक और एपिसोड में मैं आप सभी का स्वागत करता हूं। तो आप सब में से कई लोगों को शायद ये पता होगा कि हम जो है हमारे मीडिया ग्रुप के अंडर क्रिप्टो करेंसी इंडिया वीकली नाम का एक पॉडकास्ट पब्लिश करते हैं। तो इसमें जो है हम इंडिया स्पेसिफिक क्रिप्टो और ब्लॉकचेन अपडेट्स को कवर करते हैं और इसे जो है हम हर वीकेंड रिलीज करते हैं। हर वीकेंड जो है एक एपिसोड आपको मिलता है और इसे आप एक्सेस कर सकते हैं प्लेयर FM के थ्रू जो आपके स्क्रीन पर है अभी, नहीं तो अगर आप चाहें तो एप्पल पॉडकास्ट के थ्रू आप एक्सेस कर सकते हैं, साउंड क्लाउड के थ्रू एक्सेस कर सकते हैं और हाल ही में जो हमने इसे स्पॉटिफाई के साथ भी इंटीग्रेट कर दिया है तो वहां पर भी जो है आप क्रिप्टो करेंसी इंडिया वीकली पॉडकास्ट को जो है सुन सकते हैं। तो इसमें जो है हम नॉर्मली अब तक न्यूज अपडेट्स कवर करते थे लेकिन अब जो है हम स्पेशल्स लाए हैं हमारे क्रिप्टो करेंसी इंडिया वीकली पॉडकास्ट में, जिसमें हम जो है बात करेंगे क्रिप्टो एक्सपर्ट से, क्रिप्टो करेंसी के जो बड़े बड़े वॉइसेस हैं इंडिया में और ग्लोबली भी, और उनसे हम डिस्कस करेंगे उनके इनिशिएटिव्स के बारे में और वो क्या काम कर रहे हैं क्रिप्टो करेंसी के स्पेस में। तो हमारे जो पहले गेस्ट है वो है अक्षय अग्रवाल जो ब्लॉकचेन इंडिया के फाउंडर है। तो ब्लॉकचेन इंडिया के बारे में आपने सुना जरूर होगा दोस्तों, ब्लॉकचेन इंडिया हाल ही में काफी न्यूज में है क्योंकि उनके जो रोड शोज हैं वो काफी पॉपुलर हुए हैं। तो मुंबई, हैदराबाद और दिल्ली में जो है उन्होंने अभी तक रोड शोज किए हैं और आज जो है बेंगलुरु में उनका रोड शो हो रहा है। तो अगर आप बेंगलुरु में हैं आज तो प्लीज आप उनके रोड शो को जाके ज्वाइन जरूर करें दोस्तों। तो ब्लॉकचेन इंडिया के जो रोड शोज हैं वहां पर वो एक्सपर्ट्स को बुला रहे हैं, कम्युनिटी मेंबर्स को बुला रहे हैं और उनके व्यूज जान रहे हैं और इन सारे व्यूज को लेके जो है वो कंपाइल करेंगे एक रिपोर्ट में और इस रिपोर्ट को जो है गवर्नमेंट के सामने पेश करने वाले हैं। तो काफी जबरदस्त काम जो है ब्लॉकचेन इंडिया कर रहा है और साथ साथ ही अक्षय जुड़े हुए इंडिया डैप फेस्ट 2019 के साथ भी। तो जैसा आपको नाम से ही पता चल रहा है दोस्तों, ये जो है डिसेंट्रलाइज्ड एप्लीकेशन पर फोकस्ड एक फेस्ट है जो जून में होने वाला बेंगलुरु में और यहां पर जो है डेवलपर्स, ट्रेडर्स और दूसरे जो क्रिप्टो करेंसी कम्युनिटी के मेंबर्स है वो आएंगे और डिस्कशन करेंगे डिसेंट्रलाइजेशन के ऊपर, डिजिटल ट्रांसफॉर्मेशन के ऊपर और डेटा सिक्योरिटी एंड प्राइवेसी के ऊपर। तो ये भी जो है बहुत जबरदस्त इनिशिएटिव है दोस्तों और मैं डेफिनेटली लुक फॉरवर्ड कर रहा हूं इंडिया डैप फेस्ट 2019 में और मैं जो अपने पर्सनल कैपेसिटी में खुद भी जो है इसमें पार्टिसिपेट करने की कोशिश कर रहा हूं। तो आइए चलिए अच्छे से बात करते हैं ब्लॉकचेन इंडिया के बारे में, इंडिया डैप फेस्ट के बारे में और पूरे इंडियन क्रिप्टो करेंसी और ब्लॉकचेन इकोसिस्टम को वो कैसे देखते हैं उस बारे में हम डिस्कशन करते हैं अच्छे से। ये जो एपिसोड है हम ऑलरेडी हमारे पॉडकास्ट पर डाल चुके हैं दोस्तों और इसका जो वीडियो फॉर्मेट है हम अब यूट्यूब में डाल रहे हैं। तो याद रहे दोस्तों ये कंटेंट जो है इंग्लिश में है, हमारा पॉडकास्ट भी जो है एक इंग्लिश पॉडकास्ट है और यही कंटेंट जो है हम यूट्यूब में डाल रहे हैं और बीच बीच में जो है हम हमारे यूट्यूब चैनल पर जो प्राइमरीली एक हिंदी यूट्यूब चैनल है उसमें जो हम बीच बीच में हमारा इंग्लिश कॉन्टेंट भी डालेंगे ताकि हमारे यूट्यूब सब्सक्राइबर्स भी जो है इस कॉन्टेंट का फायदा उठा सके। हाय अक्षय, वेलकम टू द शो, वेलकम टू द क्रिप्टो करेंसी इंडिया वीकली पॉडकास्ट, हैप्पी टू हैव यू हियर।
थैंक यू शशांक, इट्स लवली टू बी हियर। I've been following Crypto Dost for a while now and finally, you know, it's good to have a conversation with you live on the show.
Sure. So Akshay, Blockchain India has been getting a lot of attention of late. I mean, I'm seeing some good traction, good buzz on social media. The road shows are a hit. So just tell me a little bit about how the idea came about. What does Blockchain India do? And how did the germ idea of the road show come about?
Yes, absolutely. So Shashank, it was, running a live streaming company in 2015 based out of Tim Raper's fellowship in the Valley. It was around August 2015 when I first heard the term Bitcoin. And it was crazy, you know. I was the way I was getting to meet these people, but I had no clue who they were, right? And these guys were the who's who of the ecosystem, but there I was, the techie who had no idea what the Bitcoin as a network was about. So there I realized in a quick span of 4 months that the Valley was booming about the term cryptocurrency. And so was, the partners at Draper Fisher Jewitson, Draper Associates, you know, Adam Draper at Boost VC. All of these guys were funding some amazing ideas. And I was only beginning to think, you know, what is it that's fostering such innovation in this space? And, when I ended up exiting the live streaming company around 10 months later, I realized that, you know, now it's time for me to, start dabbling into this technology. And 2016, mid-ish, was when I started looking. I was already back in India by then. And I was looking at, trying to build things over it. Obviously, start with understanding things. And I realized that there were different versions for even the theory aspects of things. You know, you could grasp a lot of things through the white paper, but, you know, the technicalities were still missing. On the infrastructural piece. And when I was on that quest to understand more, I realized that, you know, probably it'll be good to have some friends who were going through that same journey, because this was really difficult and there was very less content available. So we, Blockchain India was like almost like an inner group of 5 people. So all of us used to meet on every Thursday in Bangalore. And ironically, we used to meet at Axis Bank's Innovation Lab. So you know, that's saying something. But you know, so they had a good open innovation culture going in this facility, at least, where they gave us a spot every Thursday. We would book an hour of meeting room. And we used to just for week, for that week, whatever we learned, we used to discuss with each other, help each other with wherever they were stuck, we were stuck at. And we realized in you know, almost about 6 to 8 weeks, we realized that now we're learning so fast, and why not we open this up to everyone? Because by then we had realized that there was a lack of technologists who were looking at understanding this so essentially out there, who were looking to sort of share knowledge, and probably we might start that culture here. And some of us in the core co-founding team were open innovation practitioners. I was that time, I would say, an aspirant. I wanted to learn more about open innovation. I'd always heard that through various reports or surveys that open innovation ends up at least speeding up the pace of advancement by twice the pace when it's a restricted environment like an enterprise. Right. So I was like, probably this is one space, because of open source projects getting that fuel, a lot of people coming together remotely contributing to some projects. Right. It might be just that thing that starts open innovation as a practice.
Yes.
And now that these tokens just provided this amazing way of immediate gratification of whatever you contributed to in the vision, in terms of the vision of the project, it seemed like a lot more global than Indian. Yes. Right. And to me, that was a huge plus point, basically, because I realized that while running my startup, I realized my first win was an actual Indian win. Yes. Right. And that is something we in developing countries have been facing, essentially, that our problems, are specifically to us or a few countries like us, right? And those wins, if it's not a bigger habitual or a lifestyle thing,
yeah,
those wins just belong to one specific reason. And why not, and I always was a proponent of looking at things in the way that we technologists, why don't we help the West towards innovation? If you see, for the last 20 years, we've always been seeing, we're adopting things. But if you look at innovation with the mindset of humans, doing things to advance, their own species, yes, then it seems very unfair to only have the West bear that burden of, evolution by themselves.
Yes.
And so Blockchain India, with all of these common cultural points, started as that one meetup group wherein, I remember distinctly in Bangalore, we had about 8 people to start with. And even that time, I think there were people who, had worked with us in the past and who were curious and knew that we'll definitely be looking at something that's, ahead in time, basically, because we were used to, figuring out things of TechCrunch, following Hacker News a lot. And, this was just the tech geeks in us.
Right.
And, that sort of evolved from one meetup to now 4 chapters, yeah, one each in Delhi, Bangalore, Mumbai and Hyderabad. Yeah. And the core of it having evolved to, how do you help, again, go back to the same standpoint, how do you help in terms of innovating on the infrastructure piece, yeah, right? And now when you're looking at it, what are the things that are missing? So we realized that one thing that we did right was idea sharing through these meetups.
Yes.
Right. And also what we followed that quickly up with was, once people started building their things, we started getting them to do workshops to ensure skills are penetrated to other developers, right? So idea sharing, skills penetration were two of those things. And then we realized the infrastructure was a missing piece in India. And this critically came from my time in the Valley, wherein I saw a lot of Indian developers doing so well.
Yes.
And I saw them struggling when I was back in Bangalore. So I realized, how do we, talk to the government and build infrastructure? And unfortunately, that could not work. And probably I understand on the government's part that there is too much to take care of in a developing country, wherein, our tier 3 cities have not yet got the technologies that we take take for, what do you say, a ride where we're not even looking at them as privileges over to us. Yeah. But at the same time, you know, it's very important to for us as those privileged people who can think about technology, who can think about innovation and are not, are privileged in the sense that are not worrying about putting food on the table daily, right? So it is just upon us, how do we propagate that culture so that by the time the country is at that level wherein the basics are met, we, you know, are ready to advance it to the points wherein innovation can really happen from India, from all across the globe, and you know everyone is helping towards probably problems like singularity, that sort of, you know, everyone, every tech thought leader is wondering, and you know how is human as a race going to deal with it. Yes. So that is the piece on the Indian side. And now what we realized with infrastructure, idea sharing and skills penetration being three pillars, we realized that after the July banking ban of RBI, we realized that, you know, we took something really for granted, that regulatory environment is the most important, because, you know, we live in these networks wherein, you know, all the rules, if you don't follow, it's such a huge taboo, and we hadn't been on the other end where we tried to, you know, play with those rules or act as rebellious, you know, sort of humans, wherein we try to change the rules of the game for the benefit of mankind. And we realized that now that huge shift was happening, and maybe because a lot of people could not see, it is upon us that we help people come together and, you know, reach out to the wisdom of the crowd and use that towards benefit of one, India as a country, and then probably take it ahead to more global wins.
Yes.
So that is the vision behind Blockchain India and Open Town Hall. So you know, many of us who have been a part of the Blockchain India community or have gone through our blogs or, you know, seen our videos in terms of our FB Live meetups and all that, would have realized that we were initially for almost like about a year and a half skeptical of even talking about cryptocurrencies, right? We just used to take, you know, understanding from the point of technical advancement. And what we realized was when that banking ban happened, when, you know, we saw a lot of these good teams, you know, shutting shops, looking at ways to survive, but just did not have anywhere to go. And right. And with no institutional money sort of coming in, no VCs interested, yeah, basically because it's not even ready for mass adoption and there's not much in it for them yet. I would say from the India standpoint, I realized that, you know, you just could not have the right talent focusing on this technology. And then we realized, you know, why don't we essentially start understanding what are the real fruits behind this, what are the real problems in this space, you know. So if a lot of people say that, you know, probably payment tokens, you know, technically those that are, you know, cryptocurrencies and not just crypto assets, those, you know, provide that mechanism wherein they might end up creating parallel economy to the one that India as a country already has. Yeah. Right? And we realized, though we were not, some of us were actually economical guys as well, who understood macroeconomics, who understood how, you know, essentially, you know, India is a conservative economy.
Yeah.
They essentially tried to realize that, you know, probably how about we figure out the problems at first, yeah, and try to get the whole community together and treat these problems as opportunities.
Yes.
Really, right? And these opportunities, if had some wonderful projects. So one of the projects that, you know, was internal to the team was we were building a vigilance platform on top of you know, cryptocurrency networks, was to flag any illegitimate activities that are happening.
Yeah.
And we were like, if the government has such tools available with them, maybe they can, you know, take it to the point wherein they feel that they're in control, right? They can stop negative things from happening.
Yes.
And so Open Town Hall was just to figure out, you know, these problems. Also to figure out what people really had in their heads, basically, because we had for the last almost about 6 months, you know, we saw a lot of good leaders and, you know, specifically people who are ahead taking these campaigns to make, you know, our politicians understand, our leaders from the polity understand what, you know, this space is about, except the negative things that are highlighted so much.
Yes.
Right? And sort of the idea was to reach out to all of such brains in the community, get those right things, wrong things all in order, and on the basis of that, suggest some things that can be done. How can we, you know, proceed with an environment of innovation in a controlled sandbox controlled sort of model, right? So the idea is to, you know, come up with what, and, you know, we have seen some amazing ideas. Probably, you know, if we get a chance, I'll you know, share that as well. Yeah. But some amazing, unique things that people have said, and we had not even thought about those as you know, probable ways to go. And yeah, it was just that feeling that these roadshows, listening to so many views, getting, so already about 60 founders,
yeah,
63 founders have already participated. We're looking at another 40 odd people, because Bangalore is the hub, founders participate, in founders of cryptocurrency companies participate here. And you know, then there is something which is extraordinarily happened for the first time, is that you know, volunteers from different cities have themselves want to volunteer to run open town halls that are kind of extended models to what we do, yeah, in the four city chapters we have. And then we realized that, you know, they have volunteered to you know, record the information that gets shared there, and, you know, also help in whatever way we include that in the reports. So I think the right sort of motivation was obviously to see how we can improve, use the right things and fuel the right things in this space, as well as, you know, restrict the negative things happening out of here, right? And that was what the Open Town Hall Roadshow is about. And, you know, what we're going to follow it up with is a report that has completely different sections, one on the information, you know, that's collated from different sources. Mm-hmm. And these are all cryptocurrency companies, you know. So, for example, you also took out the time and shared your email regarding your views, you know. So the idea is to have all the unique views skimmed through that, then include that as the basis information to whatever we push out. And then we have some amazing people from the think tanks who want to suggest on top of that information how that can be used for Indian environment. Okay. But before they do that, they're also studying different jurisdictions, yeah, from across the globe who have taken some kind of initiatives. And what have those initiatives, for positive or for negative, in terms of regulating the space, what have they led to, right? So sort of also understanding this information, if we think, you know, probably a sandbox model is something that's desirable, then, yeah, then, you know, this is what happened in Crypto Valley.
Yeah,
right. Correct. And if that is good, then great. But at the same time, you know, you look at China, wherein it was banned, and what happened, the whole ecosystem went underground. So what are the conclusions that can be drawn from that? Yeah. And on the basis of it, suggest some various ways we can go ahead and you know, pitch it to the government after they've come up with their own report, saying that, boss, now you've according to you, you've done stakeholder consulting, but, you know, tell me, how many developers did you consult? How, yes, many of, so you've championed the cause through cryptocurrency exchanges, but how many of them are now in the space anymore? You, the guys that were there lobbying for the cause, are not even there anymore. So, yeah, how do you now include the new opinions of these new companies that have come to the, you know, the front? And now it's not just about developers and you know, these cryptocurrency exchanges, but also traders, right? You have to understand that if they want to be saved from any scams, yes, they, you know, but they still want to live their lives and take their chances, right? And what has that resulted, for the better or for the negative, from them? Understand that, and probably also include that as a thing. Yeah. While all these three stakeholders are important, it was very important to include lawyers. It was very important to include professors from economics background. So, for example, in Hyderabad Open Town Hall, we had Professor Bhagwan Chaudhary, who is in India since he's a guest lecturer at ISB. Then he teaches economics and finance at UCLA, right? And he has some key insights on how India was going behind, basically, because he was comparing all the jurisdictions, yeah, and trying to understand it from an economical standpoint.
Right.
So having all these complete 360 degree view is what's important when you're looking at progressing a whole section where we're proudly one of the most populated countries in the world. You know, you represent a huge portion of humanity. So you just can't be, I understand we need to think conservative in ways, but at the same time, this is a new India, as our Prime Minister says. And why don't we, you know, sort of with new India, why don't we have some new fundamentals that also has restricted experiments going on, so that, you know, we can at least help others who are you know vouching for the cause of innovation for humanity.
Yes.
And so that together is the vision behind Blockchain India and what led to the start of open town halls.
Absolutely. I think it's a shame that, you know, despite the blockchain talent that we have, we've not been able to like put a mark on the world, you know, stamp our authority on the world. I absolutely agree with you on the point of, you know, innovation stemming from India. I think the direction of innovation has always been west towards the east. I think we need to kind of change that back from India to the west. I think blockchain does give us a great opportunity, but again, I think just like it's happened in the past, again, we've kind of, I wouldn't say missed the bus completely, but we're a little late to the party. But yeah, I'm hoping that, you know, we can, like, you know, initiatives like yours can definitely boost this, that we all are trying to achieve collectively, and we can, you know, spread our message to the government. So you spoke about the town halls, right? You've had 3 town halls till now, if I'm correct. I think you've had it in Delhi, Hyderabad, and Mumbai, right? So what were the different kind of opinions? If you can touch upon something, you know, that was uniquely that came out of all these cities, that the cities bring their own sort of unique characteristics to the town halls.
Mm-hmm. Yes. So it was super interesting to see, you know, some of the, so, you know, what was great to see in Mumbai was whenever we used to talk about technology, we used to see rooms about, 60 people in the room, right? And this time in when we were talking about finance, when we were talking about cryptocurrencies, we saw 180 people, and there was no more space to essentially get even a single person inside the hall, right? And this was something that we realized, oh wow, this is what Mumbai stands for.
Yes.
Right? And what we really saw was Mumbaikers were really on point with some of the things that they closely felt, right? And they were not shy of quoting what they felt. So for example, one of the crypto exchange people, Nishchal, essentially ended up highlighting the fact that, you know, our politicians are the ones that, you know, we elect. We don't elect the RBI.
Right.
Exactly. And so RBI is not supposed to take a decision for our environment. Right?
Yes, absolutely.
And now the guys that we have elected, it's our time to see if they respond to us, if they listen to us or not. Right. And that was something that was a really high note to start with in his in his things. And he is essentially also, this was something common that everybody did. Everyone's thoughts were very well informed.
Yeah.
And, you know, it was great to see that, you know, this space sort of resembled more in the sense of people who are looking to be different than the norm. People who are looking to understand, if you're different, you have to stand for advancement. You have to stand for a cultural change that's needed,
right?
From a societal standpoint.
Yes.
And that has been something common. And, you know, some of my friends highlight that, you know, you have a response. You have a sort of romance going with the idea of these crypto enthusiasts or crypto practitioners, them trying to understand things.
Yes.
In a very larger scope, and then trying to make sure that what they do aligns with the larger, wider scope. And, you know, if you see something along those lines was I think shared by some of the core team members of Blockchain India themselves, that boss, if money is supposed to be an instrument of influence, and if that is supposed to be used positively, it has to create an impact.
Yes.
then why is it that a lot of our products are just about making more money? Why isn't it essentially about creating that wider impact?
Yes.
And if that's not happening, you're talking about a new form of money that gets in case of Bitcoin, you know, sort of generated with rules, and you could align these rules to, you know, to judge the impact that happens, right?
Yes.
So for example, if positively you're able to increase, let's say, the greenery in Bangalore, right? Though it's you know, one of the greener cities in the country, but if you're able to do that through a certain specific thing, you should be paid more than a guy who provides transaction product, right? Transactory network sort of based product. So sort of now is the time when, you know, everyone is thinking about what do you call a society 3.0? How do you use technology? How do you change the rules of the game together to benefit the society that we live in, right? So this was something, a touch base point from Hyderabad along these lines was from Kashyap, who essentially highlighted that, you know, all these philosophers, you know, and he, so I'm not, you know, following, I'm not used to following a lot of philosophers, Socrates and whatnot. And he took those examples and you said societies are formed on what these guys preached, right? And you look at these as probably religions, you look at religions as being networks driven by having some common beliefs, right? And now these societies today have those common beliefs, and you know, with the right sort of beliefs, you could take this to the next level, wherein it's just not about a particular sect, right? So that was something that started, and this is, you know, more the sociology angle, wherein you're studying society, that came, right? But if you now divulge back to, you know, I started from crypto exchange, which is a pure business angle, right? Then we went to somebody who'd highlighted societal thing, and then there was Professor Bhagwan, who ended up sharing that, you know, India for its lifetime has done the worst thing ever possible, and this is this time being lazy with trying to understand what works for the economy. You are saying that there are problems, but tell me, are there not problems with the current rupee that you have? Are they not? So for example, the three things that got highlighted in the Delhi open town hall was that if we want to help the government to you know, adopt cryptocurrency and let it grow as in a controlled environment, we have to figure out what are the challenges. And the three challenges that everybody you know, commonly agreed on was terror financing. How do you control that? You know, you scams through ICOs, the ones that were taking place, how do you control that? Right? And then sort of also understanding how do you tax things, right? Because you have to use those tax to develop a particular environment. So how do you provide solutions to those, right? Coming back to what Bhagwan sir was saying, was that you know, these problems, instead of figuring out or coming out in the open that hey, if you have a solution to this, and if we are able to solve even 40% of the problem, we are ready to give you an environment where you can try out things,
right?
Instead of taking that, you took an approach wherein you were like, I am not, there are problems, I don't understand those problems, I don't understand those solutions, and let's, you know, not do, you know, be a part of this anymore, right? So in internal consensus amongst everyone who's been a part, so all the lawyers concretely, be it Delhi, be it Mumbai, be it Hyderabad, everyone seemed to highlight the same fact that the whole process of, you know, there being a committee, there being industry consultation was formed with a mindset that had a conclusion first, and then, you know, used industry consultations in a way that they could fit, you know, those opinions in their conclusion, right? And this was all, and to their ends, it was all a sham, right? And I'm not so aggressive because I try to be open and you know, try to understand everyone's perspective. But what kind of a perspective is it if you're not even consulting major portion of this major portion of the industry, and before consulting, if you've you know, done things just to say that, you know, boss, if somebody asks us, have we done an industry consultation check? But what is the quality of it? All of us know the same thing can be done in a way it amounts to nothing, and the same thing can be done in a way that it amounts to such a huge impact. Why don't you do it the right way? Right? And we were very wary of seeing all of these opinions when they came in to you know, supplement this with a separate report which has come after already the government has come up with their report. Basically, because now is when we wanted to see the change. If you had consulted the industry and the industry had just said this, tell us now what is your opinion when these new opinions have come in, right? So this was some great things to see, and from the Hyderabad. So I'd also, because you asked about what was unique to these cities, something that was great to see was Hyderabad, and I'm also looking forward to see that in Bangalore, but I don't know how things will pan out. But Hyderabad had so many private blockchain developers, enthusiasts there. And, you know, something that came keenly from Pradeep, who works with Deloitte India and is working on a Hyperledger Fabric project. And it's a good charity platform, right? And the idea was to, and he said something very interesting, that if So the best developers or the talent in the space is attracted to the magnanimity that public blockchains have. Yes. You know, with cryptocurrencies being inbuilt into it, when you get a global task force towards a particular cause, how that could take things to the next level, right? If that was the perspective of getting talent into the space, you just killed the best people, you know, the chance of best people coming into the space by just putting that one ban.
Yeah.
Right. And what he highlighted was that, you know, though the developers from across the globe are raising millions to go after a cause, we Indians are you know, getting paid $30 an hour to build out the real tech behind those projects, right? And does that sound fair? You could see it in his eyes that, you know, he had some passion, but he was sort of, what do you say, restricted to not even be able to practice it the right way.
Correct.
Right? Yes. And that was something another, and this was also highlighted by a professor that, you know, this is not just India, it's globally happening, that the best people are coming in this space because of, you know, cryptocurrencies and the public and the new rebellious or, you know, what do you say, 0-1 industries that may start on top of cryptocurrencies and, you know, secondary markets over this new sort of economy or financial model. Yes. Right. And when you know, you take that away, you take away those hopes, you take away that opportunity of making that huge an impact and in turn getting that much amount of money in the economy, right? So probably this is that one space. Now we've already been late, right? And whereas we wanted to contribute on the infrastructure piece, you know, we're already focusing on dApps now, wherein the infrastructure gets utilized for the right ideas, right? And that's India for you. That's how regulation has failed. That's how our measures together as, you know, citizens of India have failed, right? But now it's still, there are still some chances because mass adoption hasn't yet happened. You can still come up with those things that might be middleware infrastructures,
yes,
right? Help build up that, you know, and something that was keen that came out from the Delhi, one of the Delhi cryptocurrency companies at the Open Town Hall was that, hey, tell me one thing. If our whole society is based on education, right? And are the benchmark that we set for education are the top 10 schools across the globe, right? Why is it that, you know, 6 out of these top 10 schools studying crypto economics as a specific course? If it was so negative, why would there be a particular subject on it?
Right.
So you talk about blockchain education network, people, you know, trying to figure out why don't you start courses by yourself, you know, stop waiting around for governments to, you know, approve things. Then you talk about, you know, blockchain at Berkeley, University of California student led body, which is known as a huge consulting organization. For the whole of Bay Area and even more, you know, I recently I've been connected with a lot of them trying to understand how we can, you know, do things better and follow some of their things that they've been doing to help developers get ahead. And I got a chance to interact with these brilliant people and understand that, you know, some of the guys who started these organizations about 3 years back have already, you know, for the last 1.5 years been running labs or studios to, you know, experiment with various new things in the space, and which is something that you'll see that, you know, India was going in the right direction until the July 6th banking ban happened. To me, in a lot of those lawyery words, people ended up really on you know, in front of everyone saying that, you know, this seemed like, you know, RBI ended up saying cryptocurrencies are not money and hence we are not supposed to be regulating it. But by the banking ban, they just shut down everything, right? They essentially regulated it without regulating it, yes, apparently, right? Yes. Which was not the answer. You just killed the whole innovation. Everybody, tell me one good team that's remaining here. I'll tell you 10 teams to one name that you take that have gone out. And, you know, just for their first round of funding, they have to give such, what do you say, such high portions of equity, basically because they're coming from a negative environmental standpoint, right? Yes.
Yeah.
So again, you know, now these were some of the unique opinions. Delhi was something that we saw in Delhi was Delhi is full of people who are rebellious, right? And they, if they believe in something, yes, they're definitely pull each other. And they're, if they really believe in something, they would not shy away from going to jail for their cause, right? And it was actually that, you know, that thought note was an endpoint to realizing that if, you know, there is you know, there was this concrete question asked by one of the the attendees of the open town hall, was that do we need an extra industry body? And you know, sort of we, even before that could be answered, you like Blockchain India is not trying to be one. we would like to supplement it with the efforts of IAMAI or NASSCOM, because NASSCOM also ended up predicting, putting out a report which said that only 0.2% of the world's finance into this space, investments into this space, has gone into India. Yes. Right? 0.2%. Can you beat that?
Yes.
And what is the proportion of people, or you know, in terms of population, do we have as compared to the world? At least that should have been, yes, there, right? If nothing. So you know, these organizations are doing a great job. How do we as you know, how do we as sort of drivers of a cause, help them with finding the right points? How do we supplement information to them is what we're looking at. But interesting was that they, you know, it came automatically from them that, you know, if these bodies are not able to push through, we will create a bodies of our own. And this is a lot to say about, you know, where the wind is flowing, you know, and when you, specifically when the politicians say that, you know, youth ki awaz, and, you know, sort of those terms as, you know, nation heads where the youth wind heads, right? So you have to be very critical towards understanding that. And this was said by our leaders that are in power today, yeah, right? If that is the case, you see most of the early, what do you say, 25 years old to 35 years, that's a common bracket for everyone, you know, people who have been there for like 3 to 4 years in an industry, mm-hmm, and now looking at things, though there are obviously exceptions wherein we have seen leaders also come and try to understand things and, you know, say how we can do things differently, but this is the majority, and so we need to take it as that. So again, so Delhi was that politically charged open town hall. Mumbai was, again, it's you know, you can see that, you know, it's when it's about transactions, it's about finance, you know, they're as charged as, you know, Delhiites are when it comes to policy making, right? And Hyderabad was you know, quite diverse, but I would say they swayed towards more development oriented, and they were at the point wherein they were experimenting enterprise development more, right. And you know, it was great to see that Telangana as a government, as a state government, has been able to start some things in the right way with the blockchain district.
Yes, yes.
Right? And that has also fueled curiosity to the right levels. But again, people are experimenting that, you know, are actually expecting when do they really get to, you know, try on things that they are really curious about. And that a lot of that falls into public blockchain scenario.
Yes, yes, yes. You spoke about scams, right? I mean, I also think that, you know, these scams that are happening, I think they're happening because there's not a lot of regulation that's around, you know, there's not a lot of investor information. There are no legitimate sources which the government has said that, okay, you can go here or you can go there. In the absence of that, that's why these kind of scams are happening. You see a lot of reports that people have been conned, people have been scammed, you know, but I think it's a lack of regulations which are really leading to such scams, you know. I think that's one.
Absolutely.
Yeah, whatever government intended to do with the RBI ban, I think it's achieved just the opposite. You also mentioned IAMAI and NASSCOM, right? So would that be your approach once you have the report, you know, you vet it with your think tank as well? How are you going to approach the government? Because I would assume that it would not be easy to reach the government. So are you planning to go through, say industry body like NASSCOM, or what's your approach going to be? If you've thought of that already.
Yeah, Yes. So I'll just get quickly to that. But to your previous point, you know, so the part wherein, you know, we saw a lot of you know, these things going underground, and, you know, sort of a lack of, what do you say, education. We saw some of the initiatives driven by community influencers themselves, wherein they, you know, and there's one from Anshul who's popularly did a Twitter campaign called as India Learns Crypto.
Oh, right? Yeah.
And the idea, it is again exactly hitting onto that point wherein, why don't you educate people and let them be educated so that they don't get scammed, right? Absolutely. And that's an interesting approach.
Absolutely.
So that was something that's really keen. And you see such brilliant things coming out of the community. You realize that, you know, boss, this is no ordinary space. You got some brilliant guys,
yes,
you know, who understand how things work, and just the fact that these guys are there means that this space amounts to a lot more positive than, you know, we can even you know, think negative or imagine negative about, right? So yeah, so this was interesting. And now coming back to the way we're trying to deal with the authorities, right? So I feel though the community has exploded, right? We have about 18,500 plus members, but the idea was never to become an industry body and officially deal with the government on those notes, right? Mm-hmm. And with Open Town Hall, probably if there was somebody else doing it in the right way, we wouldn't have even thought of it, right? And we though we are proud that we're able to facilitate some of these right initiatives, mm-hmm. But I feel right now how we are taking out things is whoever is interacting with the government, right? So NDA, for example, right? They have some key opinions of their own, and they directly highlighted that no developer opinion has ever been touched upon. You're talking about a space which is, even if you say it's 50% about development, tech and development, and 50% of those things, it's still, even in the equality, there is the basis of technology, right? And so you need to understand developers' perspective. And this came from India itself, right? And they're participating in the Bangalore meetup, in Bangalore Open Town Hall. And the idea is to have all of these people who have participated. If you're looking at 100 organizations, some of them were already dealing with these official, dealing with the authorities in an official manner. Right. So what we're doing is, one, supplementing them with the information that gets collated, our report insights going to them, right? Getting heard through them was one channel. And I feel, I haven't been able to get in touch with the IMAI leadership, but I'm really, something I was discussing with another mind was that we should initially be looking to supplement what they have, right? And how do we do that? Once the report is, by the time the report is out, we need to have that in their hands. Good. Right? So we need to have that connect. Right. So we're trying to make those connects. These bodies are big and they're doing a lot of things at the same time. So we don't blame them for some of the action they've already been in, and because of that they're not so accessible, so to say. But that would be one way of going. The other way is, so some of our people who are working on the report highlighted that any report of such a public influence takes in a social media sentiment as an input, right? And in those exact words by Stefano, who's one of the core team members of Blockchain India, he essentially highlighted that you just cannot believe how much impact social media sentiments have over any kind of report. Right. So what we have been doing is, if you see any of our meetup or Open Town Hall videos or photos, you would see that there's always a blackboard with the heads of all four organizations in the Union of India, the GARC committee, all of them, their handles marked, and a very subtle India for or against crypto, which is the hashtag of the camp of this whole Open Town Hall campaign, yes. have that incorporated alongside the opinion of a particular person who attended or was a part of the Open Town Hall, right? So that gets direct access even without having a physical channel to these people, right? And we're just hoping that they'll do the right thing. But if not, what we're also we are now in that, after there's been so much of coverage in the media, we have now seen that the government is a lot more responsive. Mm-hmm. I think this might just end up being one of those critical campaigns in the whole crypto revolution, and we can't take this just to ourselves. It's been so many more people, and we've just been like a platform which takes their cause and their opinions from one level to another, wherein now the media, mainstream media, picks it up. So all of this together has taken it, this whole force has taken things to a very different tone, and no longer can this be ignored. So what we are looking at is direct submission of the report to these guys, with emails to start with, apart from what we're giving as supplementary information to all of the ones that are petitioned or fighting the cause, so to say. Yes. Right. So be it NDA representing IMI group, be it, you know, talking to, you know, sort of crypto exchanges that are part of that group, everyone. Essentially, you know, we're supplementing Pocketbits. The other day was the founder of this crypto exchange in Mumbai essentially highlighted that they would like to do a report in which a critical section of the report is about, you know, the insights of what we have gotten from the whole open town hall movement. Right. And we're definitely going to consider that as a path as well. We're going to give our information so that they also directly put it. In the hearing and whatever follows the government's report.
Okay, great. So I know I think the next town hall is on March 30th, if I'm not wrong.
Absolutely, yes. Yeah, so Bangalore.
We're watching this. I would request you, please join the town hall, the last one. I'm sure it'll be awesome. I'm sure it'll be very technologically charged. I'm expecting that from Bangalore.
Actually, so we were expecting it to be a lot of, like, majorly 80% technologically charged, but, you know, Binance, the meetup that they were doing in Bangalore, they've just come to the support of this. And what they're highlighting is that, you know, after the Binance meetup, which happens in the morning, they will also guide some of the people who have strong opinions about this and who want to support the cause. They'll also guide some of those trading opinions to the town hall, and it'll still be more diverse. Though, you know, I think it's just enlightening to another point as to how Bangalore developers, how Bangalore innovators think. And I'm super excited to that.
Absolutely. And it's great that even Binance is paying attention to the Indian market. I think it will do us good, give us more visibility. I think that's really kudos to Binance for doing that as well. So I think the next in line...
Absolutely. In fact...
Sorry, yeah.
Sorry. Yeah, so I said, in fact, what was great to see was Naman from Binance's team was also there in the Delhi meetup. And it was great to see the enthusiasm he had for the same cause. So it's way more than just one particular thing.
Correct, yes. Yeah. Absolutely. So I know after the roadshows, I think your next big sort of initiative is the India Dapp Fest. So for viewers and listeners who don't know about it, can you just tell us a little bit more about the India Dapp Fest and, you know, what are you trying to achieve with that as well?
So the thought line behind India Dapp Fest is, again, from one of the fundamentals we realized we missed out, right? And we started with creating an impact on the infrastructure piece. Now we're looking at libraries or middlewares getting built. Sure. Right. So we realized that there are two critical things that are missing out. One, we have missed out on an innovation side, which now will happen on more on the dApp piece. Right. So India Dapp Fest, as the name suggests, is now how do we help everyone who's in this space to capture the next wave of impact or the next wave of innovation, which essentially will flow from middleware protocols to distributed apps getting built on top of it, right? So for example, you know, we all are seeing how social networks, you know, specifically Facebook, is being challenged on a lot of ways they run things on, right? And now distributed internet and you know, cryptocurrencies embedded in it present a particular and exactly opposite paradigm, right? And what we call it as being a part of conscious decentralization, right? And this is one of the pillars of India Dapp Fest, wherein we say that, you know, you're in a semi-centralized environment. It's not, you're not obviously living in kingships, right? And now you're talking about a space which can take it to completely decentralized environments, right? And Bitcoin is an example of that. So how do you experiment this with this whole space and understand wherever is the right degree of centralization or decentralization in the spectrum of conscious decentralization? Where are the opportunities to facilitate that, right? And that is a key piece of this. The other key piece comes from the standpoint wherein, you know, some of our leaders had you know, justified for education being there, for India Learns Crypto campaign being there. So a good standpoint is also to educate them about the negativities, right? So if you see, all of the town halls had one particularly chosen person who was really well versed with figuring out what were the scams that were happening, why was it so easily used on the dark web, right? All of those things were highlighted. So we weren't neutral. We were looking at all. So essentially, we were neutral. We weren't looking at just one side of things. And the idea now to take it to enlighten everyone on how do you, you know, buy cryptocurrencies, right. How do you deal with wallets, how do you, what are the challenges or what are the things you're not supposed to do, because technology is still evolving right now. They're not perfect ways yet to do things.
Yes.
Right. So have those kind of workshops at it, right? At the same time, have leaders who have visions as to where this whole space is going, right? Have them showcase their vision, have them showcase what products they've built to follow up that vision, and what are the opportunities for other things to be built aligning with those products, right? And concretely, something that's been missing is that because of the regulatory environment being so negative, there was lack of funds that we had mentioned about. So this is a space wherein we're looking at investors from all across the globe who are heavily investing. They sort of coming and seeing what are the right teams to interact with. Right, and how do you help them take it from an environment in India to an environment which is probably more West centric, more innovation centric, more open to general innovation or the thought piece of innovation, right? So that is also something that we're looking at doing at India Dapp Fest. Something that, you know, I had as a belief and has also gotten into the main agenda of India Dapp Fest is society 3.0 as a whole pillar, right? You are now with this new way of technology being used, this new incentivization model inbuilt into it, you're looking at changing society in ways you couldn't have even imagined was right. possible in such a short time, right? So you are now placed to build what do you call a societal tech, right? And this is not something that a lot of people have yet focused on, but this is something that I see is keen to the next 10 years. And this space is going to be the defining space, or this technology is going to be that defining technology that brings not just, what do you say, autonomous cars, or, you know, those extra those data points needed for next level technologies to be run in the same environment as humans are used to living in. You know, this will take it away from that also evolving society in a manner that we've never seen.
Right.
And though I can keep going on and on about it, but I would you know, sort of restrict that to, you know, mentioning about a couple of other things that I'm super excited about happening at the India Dapp Fest is that we are looking to demand a conversation with these decision makers on whatever state of mind they have by the time of India Dapp Fest, whatever decisions they have taken,
right.
Because the inner ecosystem, the core guys, all of them from India and across the globe are going to be, here. Why don't you come on the stage and have a one-to-one, heart-to-heart conversation, trying to explain us what would help us take this to the next level? How do we solve the problem that we haven't even thought of? If you have such things, you know, come and speak to us.
Yes.
And then at the same time, help them, you know, talk on the stage with some of the visionary from all across the globe who have been fighting the cause of, how this is the experiment that we should run and see if probably human networks efficiency increases beyond a certain, by distributing powers to, let's say, from a few key people to a few key, societal companies, right? So that is another thing that we're looking at, something that we're, discussing with. So some of our guys in the core team of Blockchain India have been core proponents of IOTA, and they've been evangelizing about IOTA since a couple of years.
Okay.
And the idea was to have what kind of impact will industry 4.0, you know, which is technically referred to as digital transformation as a space, how does that get affected, mm-hmm. with IOTA or such platforms interact with IoT products, right? Specifically, you know, electric vehicles, charging points, right? How do you do that on the basis of tokens, right? And this is something that is being experimented with in the Bitcoin city in Anaheim, right? So how do you get exposed to the things that people have realized from all across the globe? Because not everybody writes, not everything that's written that has pure quality gets reached out to you in real time when you can use that information and, you know, make that amount to something bigger, right? So all of that is what India Dapp Fest is about, and I'm super excited. I would urge, you know, so obviously Shashank, you and Cryptodost are going to be a part of it. I'll definitely see how you know the timing works for you to be a part of it. But I would really urge everyone else who's listening to us, who has the chance of, you know, hearing out our messages, come join us. You know, it's going to be that one experience wherein we are looking to grow and think of evolution driven from emerging tech standpoint of view. Sort of that standpoint, we're looking to embed in everything we do for those 5 days. Right? Come be a part of it. Be it if you're a developer, you know, be it if you're a trader, be it, you know, if crypto exchanges is something that you think are the new banks and you want to be involved in that particular space, or you know, anything that has to do with automating finance, you know, this is the place to be. And I think it's going to be unlike thoughts point of view, it's going to be unlike anything that at least we have seen, because we're putting in so many different thought pieces, so many different kind of researches into building the core content and the people that participate around it.
Yes.
Right? At the India Dapp Fest.
Yes, yes, yes. So what are the dates again, Akshay? For the benefit of the people?
So we have had to actually shift the dates, basically because, you know, the central elections counting, yes, of votes was happening on 23rd May, right? Now the dates have been postponed to 11th June to 15th June, right? Okay. And we're just going to, you know, reciprocate that idea on all our, you know, online channels. Sure. It was great that we hadn't yet. So the first half of the audience that participates is very carefully curated, which means that we're you know, asking for people to apply for invites, and then we shortlist those profiles that we see would resonate exactly with what thoughts that will flow in the whole 5 day fest, right? And then once that is done, we will open it up to everyone so that, you know, we are maintaining the quality standpoint, because this has to grow, right? This is a movement, and we believe that, you know, as humans getting together at a point, there is a certain purpose. We all will evolve after the process, and from June 11 to June 15, and then we'll take it from there, get back to creating impacts through our particular opportunities that we pick out, or that we've already picked out, with a new sort of insight or new sort of view altogether.
Yes. So I wish you all the best with the India Dapp Fest. We do hope that it's a big success. So considering the fact that now we spoke about regulations, and also the fact that election season is on, I mean, the Supreme Court has given a deadline to the government. I'm not really sure what's going to come up because of the elections again. But generally, how do you expect the ecosystem, the Indian ecosystem, to evolve in the coming year? What are your, like, you've heard a lot of people, you must have heard a lot of lawyers and all these people who understand the ecosystem well. So how do you think the ecosystem is going to evolve this year, 2019?
So 2019, I feel, is about a movement that makes India more global than we've ever seen, right? And you might think that I'm going on a very philosophical note, but this is very much on what we're seeing on the ground. You know, you're seeing remote life coming into the picture, wherein people are you know, traveling and living in different areas. They're not restricted to any one area, so to say, right? We're looking at people anyways working from the confines of an enterprise to working out of remote co-working spaces, yes, right? Yes. Now the next point, and this is just going to be the more the government, you know, procrastinates in making the right decision, the more they will elevate people and, you know, sort of their nationalist tendencies to the point that they start thinking global. And 2019 is frankly that year wherein people realize that at least the ones that can contribute to society have to look beyond national boundaries. And you know, if it's that slow as a process in India, you'll have to figure out the closest jurisdictions, yeah, right? And I feel that this year it's going to be a lot of hustle for those of us who are going to retain our national grounds. You know, we together will try to create that impact. But I feel it's at least 18 months away wherein we see a huge positive step. And if I stand wrong, I'll be, you know, if this does not happen, I'll be the first one to be, you know, so happy and, you know, sort of celebrate that. Yeah. Because that will truly mean the government is more technologically progressive as we had, you know, thought otherwise.
Sure. Great. So just a couple more questions, just very general questions now. Which are the thought leaders you look up to in the crypto space, in the global ecosystem, as well as the Indian ecosystem?
This is a super interesting question you've asked me, and the reason being that, you know, there are, so I'll tell you why thought leaders matter a lot more than we think, is essentially because every human, and I've personally felt, takes their own time to evolve to a certain idea. For example, Blockchain India was keenly focused about blockchain, and there was no cryptocurrency angle when we started at first, right? In 2 years, we have evolved to understanding what cryptocurrencies mean. Absolutely. Right? And what you'll see with these thought leaders are they're ahead in time. They're thinking, you know, at least 10 years ahead in time, and they're trying to envision a world that would probably work, you know, the best version of the world that should be out there, considering the positive aspects that are happening today, right? So what you will see is a lot of these people will end up following the names that I take probably, and, you know, they will not be able to understand what these guys say, but they will end up believing that, you know, they are at least thinking ahead. And we might not be able to understand it for now, but there is definitely some opinion there, yeah. Right? So while I say that, it's definitely very impending upon me to take just the name that I believe in, because otherwise we have an opportunity to push people in a direction we shouldn't have, right? So for example, the number one person I feel I resonate is with Naval Ravikant.
Absolutely.
Right. And Naval Ravikant, from the point of view of, you know, I saw his video almost about, I think, 4 months back, wherein he was talking at a World Economic Forum podium, and he was discussing about what this whole space is about on a very philosophical note. And he talked about monopolies, you know, that humans live in networks, you know, and these networks are owned by, now we've sort of figured out that people who are smart, they have gained a lot of powers in these networks and are acting as monopolies to those networks. Right? And I feel that, you know, that just hearing that 15-minute, you know, conversation, you know, piece from him was more impactful to my journey than anything else in this whole experiment of decentralization. Right. Second, I would say, and this is unlike anything I've felt in any other person, and this is obviously from Tim Draper, and I was so glad that at Draper University, at Tim Draper's fellowship, I got almost about 4 or 5 hours in a group to spend with him every day. And, you know, it's just something about him. He's thinking beyond, and you know, I think he's almost at a level wherein he's already thinking that, you know, with all of the distributed networks mapping out in few different ways, what is the best way we could probably, you know, link you know, efficiencies of those distributed networks to solve problems like, you know, the earth being uninhabitable, because you know, he's already taken those bets at SpaceX for interplanetary travel, at, you know, sort of at Ledger Atlas for special crypto zones, as in how do you have special economic zones wherein cryptocurrencies are so that as a project is humongous. Then, you know, Space Chain, another of his, you know, another fellow from Draper University, who essentially has taken all of the infrastructure, started taking all of the infrastructure of these key blockchains to the space, so that when the time comes, when, you know, governments start fiddling with the physical infrastructure, you know, it's out of their bounds, right? Though there are definitely technologies to go out in the space and, you know, interact with these physical things or satellites that are out there, but definitely they're ahead, and that takes away things from being so easy to becoming relatively so hard in manipulating this sort of human revolution. Right. So that, I feel he's ahead in time, and so is Adam Draper, his son, you know, with Boost VC, some of the things he's incredibly done. I really like Aragon as a smart governance project, because these distributed networks that we see are going to be governed. The decisions, the goals of those networks, the decisions of how to go after those goals, how to go after, you know, sort of, what do you say, giving contracts of work for those distributed networks to individual people are going to be super important. And Aragon is a definite in another 10 years, you're looking at a really center point use case for Aragon, right? And I don't think there's like a token investment happening there. So I'm not even, you know, sort of, I'm not on the stand saying that, you know, probably, you know, getting influenced and invest sort of a way. Yeah. So that's not the point here. And then there is an amazing project called District OX and Colony.io. Again, Boost VC, Adam Draper's project. Sort of, he's funded two more companies, which are again, the best ways of figuring out how distributed networks will work and creating platforms for those distributed networks to sort of translate, yeah. Right? So that is amazing. And another person who I feel is going to have so much power in even this new decentralized way is Joe Lubin. And I was glad to have heard him. And, you know, yeah, we were so...
I saw a photo with him on Twitter. I saw that photo. Consensus, right?
Yeah. So we were so glad that we could, since we were ahead in time, we were able to get them to kickstart in India. And the reason to doing that was that we realized that for governments to interact with startups,
yeah.
It was very difficult to do that without these guys have probably run experiments and at decent amount of scales, right? Yeah. And Consensus was that one organization that could actually give the stability of a software that gets deployed into a government kind of scale, yeah. Right? But also at the same time, be the exact interface between what do you say, an interlocking of new startups, new software products, matching with the stability that Consensus as an enterprise can provide. Right. But this is not why I mentioned Joe, but because I feel that, you know, Ethereum was definitely a 0-1 in this distributed space, and we have definitely seen its impact already. It's the developer adoption, the contribution there is unlike anything we've seen in any project except Bitcoin. Right, and sort of also begins to have some interesting questions popping out in heads, but I won't get to that because that's not relevant. But the point is that Ethereum is that 0-1 experiment. If that is that, this guy is one of the co-founders of that. But you cannot dilute the importance or let it go unnoticed. That, you know, I think Consensus is one of the most futuristic, and this is not because I believe in them, but, you know, I'm not trying to propel the idea, but the idea that, you know, Joe is thinking so far ahead, wherein he is trying to create an environment wherein Consensus builds something for not just humans, but also also machines to interact with humans and live in the same environment, right? So something that, you know, we were conversing about, and he joked was along the lines of, you know, be careful of how you're interacting with that machine. You know, we're all used to as people sort of looking to, you know, have a, what do you say, a dhakka start or a switch on, switch off, yes. A hard reset sort of a mindset.
Right.
And what he ended up highlighting was, be careful, you know, you never know what data is getting recorded.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And, you know, some great grandchild of this particular computer might end up, and this is on a very, very jokey or a very funny note, might end up, you know, taking revenge for what you did to them,
yeah,
today, right? But the thought point being that we are definitely, tech is invading our lives, with tech evolving so fast as compared to how humans are evolving. We are looking at possible tech creatures living with us and, sure, you know, going after goals, right? And yeah, this is not too far away, though it feels like a science fiction, but you have to see the drone delivery systems, you have to see autonomous cars, all of that is a reality.
It's already,
right?
coming, it's going to happen.
Exactly. Exactly. So I think that Joe Lubin as a person is definitely somebody to follow. You cannot miss him, right? And he's gonna lead us to probable positive ways. But I feel even in this era of decentralization, he definitely has next level of power,
yeah,
right? And it'll be interesting to see what this experiment showcases with such important thought leaders being in the societal networks and sure. leading the revolutionary change, so sure. to say.
Sure.
Yeah, so I think those were my three picks.
Okay, great. Just a final question for all the young students and young graduates who might be listening to us, and they want to get their foothold in the blockchain industry. They all realize that it's a sunrise industry and there are opportunities, right? So developers still kind of have a path, but strictly talking about non-techies, right? How do you think they can prepare themselves for jobs in the ecosystem? Because that's where we are heading in the next 5-10 years, right? This will become a very big industry. So how do you think non-techies can build skills to function in this ecosystem?
So Shashank, I love how you put that question. And you have to, I love the stuff you've been doing at CryptoDost, right? And great that you have such amazing points and you're covering all those things across. My answer to that particular question would be that you cannot, there is a person who decides on the vision, there's a person who executes it. Mm-hmm. It does not matter if you're the vision setter, from a technological standpoint or from an economic standpoint or from a finance standpoint or from a marketing standpoint. You just are that person that will propagate, set that vision or propagate that in ways where you have to market it and make more people believe it, right? For example, you and I are as evangelists propagating the experimental value of this whole space, right? This is more powerful in terms of adoption, in terms of the cause or the problem solution out to the tier 3 cities or the people who are not privileged to be accessing this technology so much, right? So everybody is going to have a role. Pick out, if you have a vision for yourself, lay out that vision. Remember society, so basically this is one space that's going to change sociological technologies for everyone, right? So if you have any ideas in societal tech space, you have to look at them, right? Set those visions, right? So set those visions right in terms of societal tech. If you're a vision setter, if you're a person who is able to see a vision through, right? And for example, the distributed internet vision that Tim Berners-Lee is propagating, if you believe that, if you believe what Blockstack is sort of doing in along the same lines, be the guys that help propagate the vision to the next pieces, right? And you can do that in ways wherein you get rewarded just because you're propagating the idea and getting more people adopted into the ecosystem. So as a marketeer, there are tons of opportunities. Just hit up people, look at community opportunities to influence the right thoughts in the right networks, right? That is a great thing for marketeers. That's a great thing for business development guys, basically, because if you have the right notes, you were able to strike chords with the right teams, right? And business development is as important as building technology. So you're nowhere less than anybody else, right? So in the spectrum of things, that, and then as the amazingly important space is the secondary market that's getting created on top of cryptocurrencies. So if you're a trader, you're just sitting on top of gold. This is just going to explode in terms of value, right? And make sure you capture that value. And once you have that value, you put that value to next generation things that create these kind of impacts, right? So together as humans, we are seeing society evolving, right? And whatever you do, whichever way, if you're impacting that in the positive way, you're creating value. So there is a piece for everyone, be it marketeer as a community builder, be it a tech evangelist propagating a particular set of rules for a technological platform, be it the guy who's not so much into tech but slightly into tech and more into the developer adoption piece of any platform, be it people who are helping teams coming into new areas, new jurisdictions, right, which they haven't tried. So that is again something India has keenly done for a long time, right? That if you build something important, why don't I help you reach out to the Indian market for it. So all of these are ideas, and you are bound to fit in one of these things.
Yes.
It's just a glorious world for all of us.
Great. Thank you, Akshay. Thank you so much for giving us your time, being a part of the Cryptocurrency India Weekly podcast. I really enjoyed listening to your thoughts. I mean, despite we sitting miles away, I still think I could resonate with you a lot, and I look forward to meeting you in person at the India Dapp Fest. Thank you so much.
Absolutely. Absolutely, Shishank. Thank you so much for having me. You're doing a great job with CryptoDost, and I look forward to how this evolves as an alternate media channel. And I hope the best of success to you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Akshay. Talk to you soon.
Yep. Bye.